Hello again, everyone. Welcome to our daily devotion for Sunday, February 28th, 2021. Today is the second Sunday in Lent. What a joy it is to be able to spend this time together with you in God's Word, as the Lord uses His Word to strengthen our faith in Him and increase our knowledge of Jesus Christ as our Savior. Today, we begin by reading a portion of Psalm 139. Where can I go to escape your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. If I live at the eastern horizon or settle at the western limits, even there your hand will lead me. Your right hand will hold on to me. The Lord has again affirmed his promise to Abraham that he and his wife Sarah will have a child, and that from that child will come a great nation, and eventually through that nation will come the Savior of the world. In our reading for today, we're going to see Sarah and Abraham decide to try to help the Lord along in keeping his promise. Their efforts are not going to succeed and instead are going to bring great trouble into their lives. But then we will hear the Lord again reaffirm his promise and give Abraham and his descendants the covenant of circumcision. Abram's wife Sarai had not borne any children for him, but she owned an Egyptian slave named Hagar. Sarai said to Abram, "Since the Lord has prevented me from bearing children, go to my slave. Perhaps through her I can build a family." And Abram agreed to what Sarai said. So Abram's wife Sarai took Hagar, her Egyptian slave, and gave her to her husband Abram as a wife for him. This happened after Abram had lived in the land of Canaan 10 years. He slept with Hagar, and she became pregnant. When she saw that she was pregnant, her mistress became contemptible to her. Then Sarai said to Abram, "You are responsible for my suffering. I put my slave in your arms, and when she saw that she was pregnant, I became contemptible to her. May the Lord judge between me and you." Abram replied to Sarai, "Here, your slave is in your power. Do whatever you want with her." Then Sarai mistreated her so much that she ran away from her. The angel of the Lord found her by a spring in the wilderness, the spring on the way to Shur. He said, "Hagar, slave of Sarai, where have you come from and where are you going?" She replied, "I'm running away from my mistress, Sarai." The angel of the Lord said to her, "Go back to your mistress and submit to her authority." The angel of the Lord said to her, "I will greatly multiply your offspring, and they will be too many to count." The angel of the Lord said to her, "You have conceived and will have a son. You will name him Ishmael, for the Lord has heard your cry of affliction. This man will be like a wild donkey. His hand will be against everyone, and everyone's hand will be against him. He will settle near all his relatives." So she named the Lord who spoke to her, "You are El Roi," for she said, "In this place I have actually seen the one, have I actually seen the one who sees me?" That is why the well is called Beer Lahai Roi. It is between Kadesh and Bered. So Hagar gave birth to Abram's son, and Abram named his son, whom Hagar bore, Ishmael. Abram was 86 years old when Hagar bore Ishmael to him. When Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to him, saying, "I am God Almighty. Live in my presence and be blameless. I will set up my covenant between me and you, and I will multiply you greatly." Then Abram fell face down, and God spoke with him. "As for me, here is my covenant with you. You will become the father of many nations. Your name will no longer be Abram. Your name will be Abraham, for I will make you the father of many nations. I will make you extremely fruitful and will make nations and kings come from you. I will confirm my covenant that is between me and you and your future offspring throughout their generations. It is a permanent covenant to be your God and the God of your offspring after you. And to you and your future offspring, I will give the land where you are residing, all the land of Canaan, as a permanent possession, and I will be their God. God also said to Abraham, as for you, you and your offspring after you throughout their generations are to keep my covenant. This is my covenant between me and you and your offspring after you, which you are to keep. Every one of your males must be circumcised. You must circumcise the flesh of your foreskin to serve as a sign of the covenant between me and you. Throughout your generations, every male among you is to be circumcised at 8 days old. Every male born in your household or purchased from any foreigner and not your offspring. Whether born in your household or purchased, he must be circumcised. My covenant will be marked in your flesh as a permanent covenant. If any male is not circumcised in the flesh of his foreskin, that man will be cut off from his people. He has broken my covenant. God said to Abraham, as for your wife Sarai, do not call her Sarai, for Sarah will be her name. I will bless her. Indeed, I will give you a son by her. I will bless her, and she will produce nations. Kings of peoples will come from her. Abraham fell face down. Then he laughed and said to himself, can a child be born to a 100-year-old man? Can Sarah, a 90-year-old woman, give birth? So Abraham said to God, if only Ishmael were acceptable to you. But God said, no, your wife Sarah will bear you a son, and you will name him Isaac. I will confirm my covenant with him as a permanent covenant for his future offspring. As for Ishmael, I have heard you. I will certainly bless him. I will make him fruitful and will multiply him greatly. He will father 12 tribal leaders, and I will make him into a great nation. But I will confirm my covenant with Isaac, whom Sarah will bear to you at this time next year. When he finished talking with him, God withdrew from Abraham. Many times when Jesus went to a new place, the people flocked around him and praised him and honored him for the miracles that he was performing. Today, we're going to see the opposite happen as he is rejected by his own people in his own hometown. Jesus left there and came to his hometown, and his disciples followed him. When the Sabbath came, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were astonished. Where did this man get these things, they said. What is this wisdom that has been given to him? And how are these miracles performed by his hands? Isn't this the carpenter, the son of Mary, and the brother of James, Joses, Judas, and Simon? And aren't his sisters here with us? So they were offended by him. Jesus said to them, a prophet is not without honor, except in his hometown, among his relatives, and in his household. He was not able to do a miracle there, except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and healed them. And he was amazed at their unbelief. He was going around the villages teaching. He summoned the 12 and began to send them out in pairs and gave them authority over unclean spirits. He instructed them to take nothing for the road except a staff, no bread, no traveling bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals and not put on an extra shirt. He said to them, whenever you enter a house, stay there until you leave that place. If any place does not welcome you or listen to you, when you leave there, shake the dust off your feet as a testimony against them. So they went out and preached that the people should repent. They drove out many demons, anointed many sick people with oil, and healed them. Our writing for today comes from the apology or the defense of the Augsburg Confession. The adversaries understand priesthood not about the ministry of the word and giving out the sacraments to others, but as referring to sacrifice. We teach that the sacrifice of Christ dying on the cross has been enough for the sins of the whole world. There is no need for other sacrifices, as though Christ's sacrifice were not enough for our sins. So people are justified not because of any other sacrifices, but because of this one sacrifice of Christ, if they believe that they have been redeemed by this sacrifice. So they are called priests, not in order to make any sacrifices for the people as in the law, that by these sacrifices they may merit forgiveness of sins for the people. Rather, they are called to teach the gospel and administer the sacraments to the people. Nor do we have another priesthood like the Levitical, as the Epistle to the Hebrews teaches well enough. But if ordination is understood as carrying out the ministry of the word, we are willing to call ordination a sacrament. For the ministry of the word God has God's command and has glorious promises. The gospel is the power of God for the salvation of everyone who believes. Likewise, so shall my word be that goes out from my mouth. It shall not return to me empty, but it shall accomplish that which I purpose. If ordination is understood in this way, neither will we refuse to call the laying on of hands a sacrament. For the church has the command to appoint ministers, which should be most pleasing to us, because we know that God approves this ministry and is present in the ministry, that God will preach and work through men and those who have been chosen by men. It is helpful, so far as can be done, to honor the ministry of the word with every kind of praise against fanatical people. These fanatics imagine that the Holy Spirit is given not through the word, but through certain preparations of their own. Our hymn for today is a stanza from the hymn, God of the Prophets, Bless the Prophets' Sons. Anoint them prophets, men who are intent to be your witnesses in word and deed. Their hearts aflame, their lips made eloquent, their eyes awake to every human need. And we pray, O God, you see that of ourselves we have no strength. By your mighty power, defend us from all adversities that may happen to the body, and from all evil thoughts that may assault and hurt the soul. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The focus of our Lenten catechesis this week will be the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you peace. Amen. Thank you so much for spending this time together in God's word with me today. May the Lord richly bless your day. And I look forward to seeing you again tomorrow.